Hi everyone, good afternoon. I'm Sumaira Abidi and you're watching the MF Corner, which is coming live from the newsbit at CNBC TV18. With me is Manoj Nagpal of Outlook Asia Capital. Manoj, good afternoon. Hi. Thanks very much for being here. You know, the weather outside is a little bit gloomy, so we're getting rains round the clock. But I think some of that gloom is being translated also into investor sentiment because, you know, over the last 1 year, if you see, barring some of the large cap schemes, a lot of the other investors, they say that they're making very less returns, you know, like maybe mid-single digits, just about very, very low double digits. Is there cause for these kind of investors to worry if they haven't made money in the last 1 year?
Yeah, so in the last 1 year, what has happened is that you know, both lump sum investors, you know, it has been a record year for mutual fund flows. Both lump sum investor and SIP investors have significantly increased. So if you look at the SIP investors also, in the last 1 year, the number of SIP new folios that were opened were almost 1 crore new folios. So on a base of 1 crore, so almost, you know, the SIP base doubled in the last 1 year. Now, there is a little bit of angst in these investors because, you know, they have invested in the last 1 year and most of these investors are seeing, you know, no gains in their, you know, portfolios. Now, obviously, most of these investors have come up with a perspective of 5 years, 10 years, 15 years. But it's human behavior that, you know, if you see, you know, when you invested immediately, there is no gains. People do tend to feel a little kind of fidgety about this.
Yeah.
The objective may be long term, but that's where, you know, people take brash decisions of not continuing with SIPs. And this is human behavior that has kind of been seen across various market cycles. So there are some investors who are now acting in a rash manner and stopping their SIPs. Our strong, you know, advice to such investors is that don't do this. These kind of cycles are a part of the thing. There could be more time where you may see negative returns, but over the long term, you have to realize that this strategy of doing SIP will benefit you in the long term.
Yeah, look at it as an extended sale, right?
Sale, yeah.
So you're getting everything cheaper.
Yeah.
You know, Manoj, over the last 2 days, I was at the SBI conclave, and of course, the large chunk of it was discussions around the banking space.
Yeah.
But given that mutual funds are now almost, in terms of assets that they're managing, almost one-fifth of the banking system, right? So there was a lot of talk about whether or not mutual fund houses should actually be considered as systemically important beings. The prime concern was, of course, that if there is redemption pressure, if the market continues to slide, could there be any sort of a liquidity problem? Is that something that investors have to worry about?
Yeah, so, you know, the total assets managed by mutual funds at this point of time is around 23 lakh crores. Now, if you compare it to the banking system has deposits, including the CASA, of around 114 lakh crores. You know, and this ratio was at some point of time, 5 years back, 1/10. So mutual funds used to be 1/10 of the entire banking system. Now they are around 1/5 of the banking system. Now where we need to make the differentiation is that if you were to now, you know, segregate the banking system deposits out of 114 lakh crores, around 12 lakh crores is in savings banks and current accounts, which is what we call as the demand deposits. Okay, this can be easily compared to the liquid funds or ultra short term funds. Now, if you were to, you know, take the liquid and ultra short term funds in the mutual fund industry, that's around 6 to 7 lakh crores. Now, you have to compare this 6 to 7 lakh crores with 11 lakh crores. So, in the, you know, demand deposits category, the mutual funds are actually 50 to 60%, you know, so, you know, of the demand deposits in the bank. So, which is strong or which is a very large number. And we believe it's time that the regulators start moving on categorizing these kind of, you know, the larger funds as systemic, you know, institutions also.
That's true, actually. And, you know, we have started getting some questions in. And one of them, of course, is on the Reliance Small Cap Fund. Ramesh Yadav writes into us. He wants to know what you think of this. Now, I know, you know, through the year, you haven't liked this mid and small cap space very much. And this fund, of course, it's moderately high risk. And, you know, within its peer set, I think it's what, number two or number three, I would say, high single digit returns. Is there cause for somebody to even consider this at the moment?
Yeah, so, you know, as we always say, the last 6 months have not been good for mid and small cap funds, specifically the small cap funds. And our immediate short term, the last quarter, if you see, you know, the small cap funds have got badly beaten up. So the index may actually have moved up from 10,000 to 10,700. So that's an up plus 7% in the last 3 months. But mid and small cap funds, and especially funds like Reliance Small Cap Fund, have fallen around 10 to 15%. So, you know, the underperformance is actually 22% because they have fallen 15% and the index has gone up by 7%. Now that's, you know, that's a, when that kind of underperformance happens, to catch up, it takes time. And we believe that this underperformance in small cap funds and the small cap universe of stocks in general is there to continue for some time. So if you're already invested in this, you know, you should continue and maybe average out at some point of time. And if you're looking at fresh investments, as we said, please tag your investments in the small cap category. Reliance Small Cap Fund continues to be a good fund, but the underperformance is across the category, and maybe the Reliance Small Cap has seen a slightly more underperformance vis-a-vis its peers.
Okay, the next question comes in on the Franklin India High Growth Companies Fund, which I think now has been renamed as the Focused Equity Fund, Diversified Equity Fund. But within this space, there are already other funds which are doing way better, right?
Yeah. So as I said, you know, funds which have really gone through a mandate change and also, you know, a name change, we would like to see how the fund managers changes their portfolios. We will come to know in the next few days, because by July 10th or 11th, the fund portfolios will be out, and we will need to see what is the reorientation of the portfolio. So the high growth companies fund, you know, the actually started as a small and mid-cap fund when it was launched sometime in 2007-2008. It has gone through a mandate change already and has become a multi-cap fund. And now it has again got a mandate change of becoming a focused fund. So it will prune down its portfolio to around 20-25 stocks. So we need to see what it holds back, you know, how does it create the new, you know, implementation of mandate, and then really comment. So it will be too premature for us to pass any judgment at this point of time.
So all of these changes that we're talking about in the schemes which have been reorganized is what, the 7th of July?
Yeah, so, you know, I think by 10th of July we'll get a fair sense of, you know, portfolios.
Okay, next question comes in from Rajesh Shahi. He says he has two multi-cap funds, which is Axis Multicap and the Kotak Select Focus Fund. He wants to know if he should look at stopping one or the other, or perhaps continue with even both.
Yeah, so, you know, both the funds follow a completely distinct approach, and that's what we, you know, when you are diversifying, you should identify two funds with a completely distinct approach. So the Axis is a more value oriented approach, whereas Kotak, you know, what was earlier known as a Select Focus, you would have invested in, now the multi-cap fund, follows a growth or momentum oriented approach. So having two distinct styles. So for example, if you look, the Axis fund in the last 1 year has been a, you know, outperformer, and the Kotak fund would have been an average performer. Whereas if you were to go 1 year back beyond that, the situation was always the reverse. So we like this approach of identifying two different investment styles and keeping that. So this kind of diversification is good, and you should continue with both the funds.
All right. In fact, there is another person who has written in on the multi-cap funds. He wants to know, which is Vinod Sundar Vardhanam wants to know which is a good multi-cap fund. So is there one of these that you could recommend? Because we also have, you know, the Motilal Oswal multi-cap, which has quite a high ranking. I mean, what would be your pick model?
So I would say, the, you know, as you rightly said, the Motilal fund is definitely one of the good funds. And we have to understand what is happening in the last six months to a year. You know, the leadership in the market has changed. So earlier, you know, whereas the momentum style was doing well, now suddenly defensives in the last 1 year, actually, if you see what is driving the markets is IT, pharma and consumer goods. and most of the funds across the category are underweight these kind of three sectors. So what we recommend is that identify two, three funds. So ideally you should go with the Motilal Multicap Fund, which is an extremely good growth oriented strategy. You could add a Birla Advantage Fund, which follows a little bit of value at a, you know, kind of a strategy. And we also like the Axis Multicap Fund, you know, which also provides a distinct third style. So you could look at these three funds and go ahead with your, you know, investment strategy.
Okay, there was somebody who had written in to us asking about the large cap funds. I can't seem to find that question right now. I'm going to come back to it. For now, let's see a question from Rahul Yaduvanshi, who wants to know that he wants to get monthly returns. Therefore, which mutual fund would be the best in with a decent capital? So I think more than which fund, I suppose you want to tell him which is the best way to actually organize returns through the mutual mutual fund route, because a lot of people mistakenly also invest in the dividend option thinking that it's going to work out as a return.
Sure. So, you know, the last 2 years has been a, you know, a big missell where balanced funds were sold to people saying that they will give a monthly dividend. And that category has grown a lot. So if you are alluding that if you want to invest into that category, we feel that a balanced fund category kind of a fund cannot give monthly returns because of its high exposure to equities. Whereas there are other category known as the balanced advantage funds. The ICICI Prudential Balanced Advantage Fund is the leader out there, which keeps on changing its equity allocation from 30% to 70%. Again, we feel that even at a 30% allocation to give out monthly returns is a little tough. So ideally, you should go into the erstwhile monthly income schemes which are there. They are now known as the regular income schemes, which can give you a return in the range of 7 to 8%. And the better way to take your monthly returns is in the form of a systematic withdrawal plan. So don't go in for the other category if you're looking at a monthly return. Go into the regular income category, which has a 10 to 15% exposure to equities. On the higher side, it goes to 20%. That is more amenable to giving you a monthly income rather than the other categories.
Okay, and this also goes to underscore our own point that when you're investing in mutual funds or selecting your funds, select it on the type of need that you have. So Rahul has given us his need quite specifically, which is that he wants monthly returns and hence the recommendation. So always try and see what it is that you need money for. Sajan Matthews has written in to us. He wants to know which funds to start your investment with when markets are at a high. The SIP amount he's looking for is 10,000 rupees a month for the next 20 years. So Sajan, I'm assuming that you don't have a portfolio of mutual funds and you're looking at this as a fresh investment. So therefore, 10,000 rupees, 20 years, how would you divide it?
So if you look at the time horizon and do a study of the last 15, 20 years also, for example, let's take the specific case of the last 10 years. The last 10 years have been a little volatile and there have been a cycle. 2008, say the markets fell down, then they revived back and now they are in a flat zone. So it's a complete cycle. So if you see in the last 10 years, large cap funds would have given you returns in the range of around 12 to 13%. And that's what the index has also given you. So large cap funds have given a slight alpha, but not significant alpha. If you were to go one step into the higher risk, the mid cap funds have given the returns in the range of around 17 to 18%. And the small cap funds have given a return of around 18.5% to 19%. These are average returns of each of the categories I'm telling you. What you can decipher is, and this is a good thumb rule that you should always keep in mind, is that the typical large cap to multi cap funds will give you returns somewhere in the range of 50% more than the inflation. So if you see the average inflation in the last 10 years has been around 8%, 50% on top of that will give, that is 4% add 4% to 8. So that becomes around 12% is what a large cap fund will give you. Another 50% uptick on that is what the mid cap and small cap funds will give you. So 12% is the large cap category. So you take 50% of that, it's 6. So you add 6 to 12, that becomes 18%. So that's what mid-cap funds have given in the last 10 years. Now, where you need to think is that that outperformance typically is only really available in the long periods of time, which is 10 plus 15 years. So if you're looking at a 10 to 15 years, you can start your, at this point of time, also an SIP into a mid and small cap fund. But as I said, be cautious and don't get worried in the short term.
All right, so this answer also holds true then for Jagan Kodandapani, who has written that all large cap, mid cap, balance, multi cap, thematic, all of these funds are down, which is a better fund to invest in. So Jagan, like Manoj said, if you're looking at the next 10 to 15 years, I suppose almost every category is going to do well. And if you're looking at making a fresh investment, then you can even look at a mid and small cap space. Shoaib Kalatra wants to know about the Kotak fund, and he also wants to know about equity funds over the long term. So I think pretty much this has answered your question. I mean, the Kotak set of funds would also feature in this list,
sure,
right?
One of the things you should also remember is that, we are not expecting that the 8% inflation of the last 10 years will continue forward. You need to understand the inflation in the next 10 years is going to be very subdued, and hence accordingly, your return expectations have to change. You cannot expect the same 18% return going forward in the next 10 years. So just keep that in mind when you're investing and have realistic expectations.
All right. I think somebody was listening in to your question, to your answer when you were talking about the SWP. He wants to know what is a hybrid SWP?
Well, it's a SWP which you do on a hybrid fund. So if you're looking at a balanced fund, which is a mix of debt and equity, there could be an hybrid SWP that you could set up. But that's just a technical Basically, the concept remains the same, that you withdraw your capital plus returns rather than just trying to withdraw your returns. So what happens is that because of a SWP feature, it becomes a more tax efficient method of doing it.
Okay, we have Rajan Shahi who's written in to us and he wants to know about the liquid fund where the returns are high. Now, I don't know if that's the objective you're looking for in a liquid fund.
Yeah, so, you know, liquid funds will give you call money plus minus rate. Mm-hmm. So currently the call money rates are in the range of around 6%. So you should only expect, 6% plus minus kind of returns that you're looking at. No liquid fund will be able to give you substantially higher returns than the call money rates or substantially lower also. So the range is very tight in a liquid fund, and that's the objective, that the money you can park it for one day also and get that kind of a return. So, you know, liquid funds, typically you should only be looking at the expense ratios. Choose the liquid fund with the lower expense ratio and you should be good to go.
Rajesh, I hope that, when you're asking about a liquid fund, that you have a particular need which meets this requirement where you need to invest for a shorter period of time. All right, up next, we have a question coming in from Umesh Pundey, who wants to know what you think of the SBI Hybrid Fund, the Edelweiss Balance Advantage Fund, as well as the HDFC Small Cap Fund and the Axis Multi Cap Fund. So the multi cap space, I think we've discussed quite a bit as we have the small cap space, but perhaps the SBI Hybrid and Edelweiss Balanced Advantage.
Yeah, so the SBI, when we talk of hybrid fund, the SBI at this point of time has one close-ended fund which is going by the name of Dual Advantage Fund. So that's also an hybrid fund. And there is the normal balance fund. So I assume you're talking of the NFO which is there at this point of time, which is a close-ended fund and which is in the news. So that is more a replacement of a fixed deposit with around a 30% exposure to equities. We typically don't recommend close-ended funds or, NFOs of this kind. However, SBI has seen a lot of traction in this, primary because this product gets sold through the SBI branches to people who come to renew their fixed deposits. We don't think that's the right strategy they are doing. However, but they have seen huge amount of traction in the last 1 year by collecting funds out there. If you're looking at the SBI Balance Fund, that's one of the average performers again. And we typically tend to look at, other funds than the SBI Balance Fund as a, category to invest in. Coming to the HDFC Small Cap Fund, HDFC Small Cap and HDFC Mid Cap have been star performers in the last rally of funds. It continues to be a good fund to invest in, and we strongly recommend that if you're looking at a small cap exposure, this could be one of the funds you could consider in investment.
All right, we had a question, sorry.
Yeah, and then there was the other two funds, right?
Yeah, the Axis Multicap, and I can't now find the last one.
Yeah, Axis Multicap was, anyway, we said that it was one of the good funds to look
at. HDFC Small Cap.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. We had a question coming in on an insurance plan, somebody wanting to know about the SBI Privilege Plan, but that's outside of the scope of the discussion we are having, which is purely mutual fund investments. Chandrika Goyani wants to know which pharma fund is best for a three-year time horizon and should they go for it at the moment. Now in pharma, I don't know whether they're referring to a sectoral fund or a thematic fund. Some of them are in play. Pharma itself has been buzzing quite a bit.
Sure.
But for a period as short as 3 years, would you recommend someone to opt for it?
Yeah, so the way pharma plays out is that one, is it a defensive sector to look at? And typically is a structural growth story in a country like India. However, we always feel that a pure play pharma fund, sector fund, may not be the right strategy to go ahead. And maybe a larger mandate of a healthcare fund could be a fund that you could consider. The reason we say that is that apart from the pharma companies, which are a little more sensitive to the announcements coming from the US in terms of approvals, healthcare sector fund, which actually goes into diagnostics, hospital chains, and which is really the space which is going to expand phenomenally in India as a year. So if you do a healthcare fund, you will get both the things put together. And two of the funds which are there in the market at this point of time is the Mirae Healthcare Fund and the ICICI PSG Fund. Both of them are targeting this larger theme, and we could tell you that both of these funds could fit your profile.
All right, one last question then. Pallab Basak has written to us. He's looking to invest about 25 lakhs for a 12-year time horizon, and he wants to know how he should break up this lump sum investment and basically where do you put the money?
Yeah, so one of the good things always to remember is that apart from the time horizon, you also need to assess what is your risk taking ability. For example, two people of the same age could have completely different risk profiles, though their horizon may be the same. It depends on your own individual capacity. So typically we say that 10 years plus, you could start investing in equity funds because that's long enough time frame for, you know, the volatility to get digested by the fund and by the investor also. So ideally in this scenario, you could look at, you know, pure equity allocation. However, as you go along, you need to reduce your allocation because you have a very specific time frame in mind. So maybe at the end of 8-9 years, you should start changing your, you know, profile into more of debt. So that's the way you should go about doing this.
All right, well, that about wraps it up for today. Manoj, thanks very much for joining in, and I hope you benefited from Manoj's advice. We'll wrap up for today with the promise that on Tuesday at 1 p.m. we'll have Anubhav Srivastava joining in to answer the many questions that we couldn't answer today and also talk a little bit about what's happening. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.